The ultimate result would be to encourage and facilitate world trade, education, entertainment, and many kinds of professional, political, and personal discourses which are essential to healthy human relationships and international understanding.
The beginnings of a great human conversation. These post office earth stations at Goonhilly and Madley are part of one of the most complex machines ever made, the World Telecommunications Network, which enables the whole world to communicate more easily. Their job is to relay calls through space. Telephone, telex, telegrams, data, facsimile, television. It was the Englishman, Arthur C. Clarke, who in 1945 originated the idea of a global network. Three satellites hovering above the equator at a height of 22,300 miles. Their orbital speed exactly matching the rotation of the Earth. He saw that radio signals could be transmitted from one Earth station via a satellite to any other Earth station within the satellite's beam. On the way to the realization of this idea, there were some disasters. And there still are. After months of preparation, the total destruction in seconds of £25 million worth of satellite and launch vehicle. Even the first attempts at intercontinental communications met with fearsome hazards. Brunel's Great Eastern, laying telegraph cable across the ocean for messages sent in Morse code.
Mr. Watson, come here! I want you!
With Alexander Graham Bell came the first rudimentary telephone system. After Marconi, it was only a matter of time before the human voice was crossing the Atlantic by high-frequency radio. Then by undersea cable, now a major part of the telecommunications machine. Cables gave much clearer and more reliable telephone calls and carried many more calls. For television and high-quality radio calls, there had to be a line-of-sight microwave system. Between America and Britain, the Earth's curvature makes this impossible. There'd have to be a great many relay towers, or one in the middle 500 miles high. A little impractical. How was it to be done? Satellites in geostationary orbit. And how to get them up there? Konstantin Zilkovsky, a Russian school teacher born in the mid-19th century, worked out how to launch satellites by rocket, seeing in them a means to explore space. Rockets developed during the Second World War were the forerunners of the satellite launch vehicles of today. Cape Canaveral has been the scene of all the rocket launches by NASA for Intelsat, the International Telecommunications Satellite Organization, a consortium formed by 11 nations in 1964 to make Arthur C. Clarke's global network a reality. Intelsat now has over 100 member nations. The first satellites like Relay and Telstar in the early 1960s orbited the Earth at low altitude and could be used for only 20 to 30 minutes at a time. At that time, there were only three Earth stations. Andover in the USA and Puma Boudou in France both had horn-shaped aerials with a protective radome. These proved expensive and less satisfactory than Goonhilly's open dish, which set the pattern for all future Earth stations. These experimental beginnings, with the information they supplied, led to the first attempts to place a satellite in geostationary orbit. Early Bird in 1965 was the start of a commercial service. Less than 2 feet high, it could handle 240 simultaneous phone calls or one television broadcast. Intelsat 2 in 1967 was bigger, but similar in capacity. Intelsat 3 in 1968, six times as many circuits and nearly twice as big again. The much larger Intelsat 4 in 1971 had a capacity of 4,000 circuits plus two television channels and was over 17 feet high. Intelsat 4A, launched in 1976, handles 6,000 simultaneous calls plus two television broadcasts and is 22 feet high. By early 1979, the total number of satellites in orbit in the Intelsat system had reached 13.
Oh, she looks great. A real star.
I'll get on to our agent. Hi, get me Joe in New York. Yeah, Trina. Fantastic.
A satellite call goes from office to local exchange to international exchange. Then, either by microwave radio from the post office tower or coaxial cable to the Earth station. It's then transmitted by satellite to another country.
Hello? Yes? Oh, hello. Yeah, did you just get back? Great, how'd the job go? Super. Yeah, I've just been reading about it, actually. Yeah, and guess what? Can you believe this? My agent just called me and I just got a part in a film.
International phone calls have grown dramatically. By 1979, there were some 750,000 a week, two-thirds of them through the satellite network.
Namaste ji. Tu se kidda ho? Theek ho? Bacche school chale gaye hain kahan nahi?
However distant the country you're phoning, the call is often as clear as one within your own town.
Okay. Right. You can pick us up at the airport.
Advances in technology have helped in another way too. Most international calls were cheaper in real terms at the start of 1979 than when Early Bird went into orbit 14 years before.
I knew I left something in that hotel room. What's the address? Beauvallon Bay? Seychelles.
Is the Goonhilly Down radio station of the British Post Office calling America. For us, this control room has tonight made history. Tonight, this equipment received perfect pictures from Telstar.
Good morning, Gene. Charles Booth speaking here. May I first congratulate you and everyone in the United States who has been concerned with the Telstar launch. It is indeed a wonderful achievement. And we in the United Kingdom know it represents a major step forward in communications. We are very proud to take a part.
Goonhilly has had many firsts. First to transmit live television from Europe to America via satellite. First in telephony tests. First to transmit color television. It's one of the busiest Earth stations in the world. To meet future needs, the Post Office started construction of a second Earth station, Madley, in the mid-70s. The first aerial was completed in 1978, capable of handling over 1,000 phone calls at a time, plus television. It's working to a satellite over the Indian Ocean. A near-perfect parabola, its size and shape governed by its function, it focuses radio energy into a beam, like a searchlight. The matte surface of the dish diffuses the heat of the sun's rays. The aerial is steerable and automatically makes imperceptible adjustments in tracking as it follows a beacon on the satellite. A wideband microwave radio system is used, transmitting and receiving signals simultaneously via the aerial. The incoming signal is only a tiny fraction of a watt in power. Rather like the heat you might receive on Earth from a one-bar electric fire on the moon. Travelling from the aerial down the beam waveguide to the equipment below, the incoming signal is amplified many times. The electrical components of the amplifier are cooled to minus 253 degrees centigrade, near absolute zero, so the background noise won't swamp the incoming signal. The signal is then amplified many more times and converted to frequencies used in the terrestrial network. These are some of the services that the satellite system helps provide. Facsimile, telex, automatic service to well over 100 countries. Telegrams worldwide. Data transmitted over ordinary phone lines. Phone calls dialed direct to over 80 countries by the beginning of 1979.
Hello.
International phone calls are doubling every 4 to 5 years. Manned switchboards and exchanges used to be necessary for all international calls. By the beginning of 1979, most people in Britain could dial direct to 85% of the world's 460 million telephones. Telephone and telex calls to ships at sea. Television. Many people don't realize all intercontinental television comes through an Earth station.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Excellent in Churchill. On Marie, citizen.
We are in the Rose Garden of the White House, just outside the President's
office. Proclaiming him an honorary citizen, I only propose a formal recognition.
Tom Hill, how is your reception?
Hello, Comstock. Freedom.
And whereas his bravery, charity and valor, both in war and in peace, have been a flame of inspiration in freedom's darkest hour, and whereas his life has shown that no adversary can overcome and no fear can deter free men in the defense of their freedom, now therefore I, John F. Kennedy, President of the United States of America, under the authority contained in an act of the 88th Congress, do hereby declare Sir Winston Churchill an honorary citizen of the United States of America.
Tom Hill calling. Picture and sound both okay. BBC states clearest ever seen via transatlantic relay. Sir Winston observed the program at his London home and was deeply moved.
Goonhilly in Cornwall is built on foundations of hard rock. The space age shapes of the aerials are features on the stark landscape. At Madley in Herefordshire, there's rural beauty of a different kind. Landscaping and tree planting on the site blend with the surroundings. Some people would say it's beautiful in its own right. And certainly it's silent, motionless, and there's no danger from pollution or radiation. There were a number of reasons for choosing Madley as a site. The station had to be far enough south to see the Indian Ocean satellite, which is just above the southeast horizon. It needed to be situated in a natural bowl away from radio interference, such as the UK and French microwave systems. Needed to be as close as possible to London to minimise the cost of ground links. Future growth in calls will mean a total of up to 6 aerials on the Madley site and possibly more at Goonhilly as well. Madley and Goonhilly Earth stations are owned by the External Telecommunications Executive, the arm of the British Post Office, whose job it is to provide the country's international and maritime links in cooperation with other countries. International cooperation keeps the machine running smoothly. If it failed, the effect would be sudden and crippling.
Hello? Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Sammy?
Hello?
Hello? Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hello?
Hello?
Hello? Is anybody there?
The post office, along with its counterparts in other countries, has a part to play in making sure this never happens, and in developing newer, cheaper, and more efficient means of communication. Space Shuttle is an American manned craft that's boosted into space by a rocket, but lands like a conventional aeroplane. A new launch vehicle for some satellites in the 1980s. It was test-landed after being launched from the back of a jumbo jet. Later versions of Shuttle could make it possible to visit, repair, and retrieve satellites. Intelsat 5 is the latest type of satellite with 12,000 circuits plus television. Solar wings extend 52 feet across. At Goonhilly, Aerial 4, a 62-foot diameter dish, went into service in 1978, sending speech and television signals to a test satellite for a European regional system. The test satellite came after 8 years of study and development and was the prelude to the launching of an operational European satellite. Ariane, a rocket developed by the European Space Agency. Quite enough to keep people talking. This great and complex machine continues its work. It enables millions of people throughout the world to communicate more easily and to be in touch with events as they're actually happening.
County, all recorders and oscillographs to fast.
County looks pretty small down there now, Houston.
We're carrying a big stick, though.
A fantastic sight.
Happy birthday, Mother.
Okay, Houston. The moon is essentially
coming up on pitch over.
64.
The eagle has landed.
Yeah, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Knight, I think I can say without contradiction, there's been a mighty long drive.
Okay, we're moving forward, Joe.
Roger.
We came over those mountains. This is really a rock and rolling ride, isn't it? The most beautiful thing I've ever seen. Okay, Jimmy, let's go to work.
Jamal, looking at yourselves as seen from 180,000 miles out in space.